To recap, we've covered GPA and what you're trying to get to be set up to look good on your applications. Same with GRE, and we just finished talking about letters of rec in terms of who to get them from, ideally, what ideally they're saying about you and how they're talking about you in those letters of rec, and some of the transferable skills that might be mentioned as a part of that. So in addition to GPA, GRE, and letters of rec, another piece of what will go into your application is your personal statement, as well as potentially a writing sample, and sometimes particular responses to specific questions they might ask in their application. If I have feedback about any of these pieces, it would be around the personal statement and things they might ask you to say. In terms of some tips or things to keep in mind, and again, those books I mentioned earlier on, the guides to getting into graduate school in psychology, those can be useful in helping you think about your cover letter and/or your personal statement. But in these things, what you want to do, among other things, is tell them a cohesive story about you as a person and a professional. Because when it comes to our field, the personal and the professional meet. Because the person, who you are, and your interests and your values will inform the kind of research you do, and the type of therapy you do, and the type of student you are. So it's about telling some interesting and compelling story about yourself that hooks faculty's attention and that can help you stand out and seem more on the unique side. Now, your personal statement is often, in my opinion, the personal statement can help you stand out, and it can show your writing ability. So good command of the English language is important to show in everything that's written in your applications. But a lot of times, the big kind of make or break determinants will be the GPA, GRE, strong letters of recommendation, and then they're looking at your CV, which is, the academic version of a resume, because your CV will talk about your clinical and research and volunteer and class experiences. And those are kind of the really substantive stuff that faculty will definitely look at. And a lot of times, your personal statement, it may be the tipping point in terms of getting you an interview or making you less attractive for an interview, but it's not necessarily the most important thing in the world. A lot of times, if the personal statement is written appropriately and there's no glaring errors and the style is fine and you're, reasonable in what you say, if your other stuff, your GPA, GRE, letters, et cetera, are strong, your personal statement won't end up making that huge of a difference, perhaps, because it can be more of the icing on the cake. Whereas maybe if those other parts of your application are less strong for one reason or another, then hopefully you can kind of make up for some of that by having a stronger personal statement. And you certainly want to avoid a weak personal statement where it shows errors or lack of attention to detail, or is really boring, or you're not answering the questions that they ask, or shows kind of ignorance to important things. Like, that can definitely sink your application, so you don't want to bomb it. But it's not necessarily the most important thing in the world to get perfect. You don't need to be a perfectionist about it when the other parts of your application are fairly strong. So that's one thing I'll say. That might be, maybe some other professors wouldn't agree with me, but I guess that's how I can see it. Because in some ways, your CV and your other stuff can give me perhaps a better sense of how likely you might be to succeed in graduate school. Though I really enjoy the personal statement, because that's really the place where I can learn about who you are. It's kind of who you is, the person you are, the uniqueness, and that narrative can really paint a picture of who you are, which I think can be very important for some faculty, because people will envision, what is this person like based on how they describe themselves, and think about, would I enjoy, does this person seem cool, do I want to meet this person, would I want to work with them, might I want to bring them on for an on-campus interview to possibly be one of my advisees. And I don't have a ton to say about the personal statement and tips and stuff. That's not as much my forte. Other people have articulated kind of do's and don'ts pretty well when it comes to that. But in terms of general things, kind of like I mentioned with the letters of rec, when you're making claims about your capacity or abilities, it's always great to do that claim backup evidence, claim backup evidence sort of structure, where when you're asserting that you have a quality, you give an example or a concrete kind of specific about how that was shown, as that can make your stuff feel more substantive. One other key piece I'll leave you with is, because PhD programs are interested in people who are both interested in the science and the practice side of being a counseling psychologist, it's important in your application materials to speak to both of those parts. It tends to be, it's going to be extremely hard generally for someone who says, you know, I just really love clinical work and I just want to do clinical work, and, you know, research, it's okay, I could take it or leave it. It's really hard to get into a program if you kind of describe yourself in that way.
But so the PhD, particularly if it uses the scientist-practitioner model, PhDs want to work with students who have interest in both research and practice, because the training model is about teaching people to be able to make original contributions to the research literature, as well as to learn to be a good therapist. And the scientist practitioner model stands in contrast to the scholar practitioner model. And the scholar practitioner model is followed by a lot of PsyD programs where there's a greater emphasis on practice, and the scholar part means that you're able to digest and understand the literature and use that to strengthen your work, but there's not the emphasis on creating original knowledge as a scientist. So that's how the scholar practitioner and the scientist practitioner models vary from each other. So to come back to the PhD part, the PhD is really meant for those students who want to learn to become scientists as well as practitioners, and therefore have reasonably strong interests in both sides of that professional identity. If you're a student who is primarily only interested in the practice side, then a scholar practitioner, PsyD, or a master's level degree is often a more truer fit for your interests. Although what ends up happening is that a lot of people who go into PhD programs that are scientist practitioner, I'd say the majority of them actually do go on to be in practice settings where they may not really contribute to the research literature and be involved in publishing things, though they, from their training, would have the skills to go ahead and do so if they chose. That's just an kind of an interesting reality, is that a lot of people end up going to the clinical work side. And there can be various reasons for that. One of them is that it's probably more difficult to get an academic position. I know, just like getting into a PhD program has gotten harder over the years. It's the same thing with getting a faculty job. And a lot of the reasons for that is there's not a ton of faculty positions open at any given time. And so you've got lots of people graduating from the 70 or so programs across the country in counseling psych, and only a few of those programs are hiring. So there might be between 3 and, say, 15 positions open at any given time, and that doesn't at all match the number of graduates who are out there. So it can be difficult, and that might be a piece of why more people go the practice route. And I think in general, people who like the research side, I think sometimes it can take a special set of skills and interests and values in a person to really like and really jive with the research side. And so that might be a piece of it too, is that a lot of people get into our field primarily because they're interested in practicing therapy and the idea of that and helping people directly. And so a lot of people will enter the field thinking about the practice side of things, and then some of them discover the research along the way, and then they might emphasize the research even more in their future career path. But some people do know that they want to go the research route from the start, and that's reflected in how they prepare for and enter graduate school. But that's a little, I guess, additional context on who tends to be a good fit for a PhD program, is that it's folks with strong interest in both research and practice, ideally. So we have at this point covered, we've been talking about the personal statement and that part of the application, and that in your personal statement, not only are you talking about yourself as a person and your clinical interests, as well as your research interests and that side of it.